Welcome to Game of Thrones Season 7, Crammed. This is the season that looks as epic as ever, even if it does start to feel like awkward fanfiction from time to time. Don't forget to click that subscribe button, and let's go. We return to the Twins, where Lord Walder Frey, apparently alive, is holding another feast with his entire extended family. Everyone's real proud at slaughtering the Starks back at the Red Wedding, but the women aren't allowed to drink. Well, turns out that winter has come for House Frey, as Arya Stark has used her faceless assassin skills in a poison wine revenge attack and wiped out an entire house in a single move. Damn. But despite being a killing machine, she still has her humanity and can see that not everyone needs to die when she comes across a group of Lannister soldiers that are just a bunch of normal blokes who want to go home. But don't forget that in the far north, the dead are now marching, led by the White Walkers that bring the winter with them. Fortunately, Bran and Mira are still just ahead of them and make it to Castle Black on their way to reach King Jon, who is also taking things seriously in Winterfell. The Northmen need dragonglass to kill the White Walkers and to train up every man, woman, and child for the upcoming war. Meanwhile, Tormund is going to take the wildlings over to Eastwatch by the sea to help bolster the defense of the wall alongside the Watch. He still fancies Brienne, but she's concerned about Littlefinger still hanging around the place and sniffing after Sansa, who thinks that the surviving Bolton sympathizers should be stripped of their homes as rewards for their allies in the Battle of the Bastards last season. But Jon instead would rather have the remaining Karstarks and Umbers re-swear their loyalty to the Starks for the sake of the United North. Jon has to remind Sansa not to call him out in front of the other lords, but she has a point to make about being smarter than Ned was. And despite the dead to the north, Cersei is still a terrible threat from the south. She's with Jaime down in King's Landing, standing very specifically on a map for the sake of possible foreshadowing, and word is out that Tyrion has joined up with Dany and is returning home. Jaime's not sure if war and hatred is still the best way to go, but Cersei has enlisted the forces of Euron Greyjoy. This season, he's more of an evil rockstar than before and wants to marry the queen. Jaime doesn't trust the creep, but Cersei wants that Iron Fleet, so Euron's going to bring her a gift to prove his loyalty to the crown. Over at the Citadel, Sam's internship is mostly just cleaning shit and tidying books on endless repeat. But there's a restricted reading area that's caught his eye, and he needs all of the info on the others that he can get for the war to come. Maester Marwyn believes Sam's stories, but doesn't quite believe that it's the end of the world, keeping him on scrub duty. So he studies what little he can along with Gilly, who's learned to read, and discovers that Dragonstone has huge deposits of dragonglass, ripe for mining. And it also turns out that Ser Jorah is here, all the way over from Meereen, his grayscale now in an advanced stage. Heading up north for Brotherhood Without Banners, come across a farm the Hound has been to before back in the Arya days, and it looks like the family didn't make it. Sandor quizzes Beric as to why the Lord of Light keeps bringing him back from the dead, but he has no idea. But Foros does get the Hound to have a go at looking into the flames, and Clegane gets a vision of the Wall, the Whites, and Eastwatch by the sea, before taking a moment to lay the bodies of the dead to rest. And right down on Dragonstone, looks like Stannis left it empty, Daenerys Stormborn has finally returned home to Westeros with her dragons and drinks in her ancestral home with her crew at hand, ready to begin. In the halls of the old Targaryen seat of power, Dany is under no illusions about looking like an invading enemy and wants to take the Seven Kingdoms without simply just burning the people of King's Landing to the ground. Varys gets put on blast for working under the former King Robert, but he's resolute about choosing to help the right queen instead of just blind loyalty, and Dany seems pleased. And Melisandre has popped over for a visit to talk about the prophecy of Azor Ahai, believing Dany has a part to play as well as Jon Snow, who she might want to have a meeting with, seeing as they share the same enemies. And even Davos up north thinks that some dragons might be nice for burning the dead. So with an invite from Tyrion and a whole load of dragonglass to go mine, Jon decides it's worth heading down for a hello, despite everyone's concerns about it being a trap. But the North needs all the help it can get, and so Jon puts Sansa in charge whilst he's away, a role she may well be suited for. Down in the crypts, Lord Baelish tries sucking up to the king, but Jon is a bit wiser to the world, and Littlefinger's really just cruising for a bruising. The Sand Snakes, Good Greyjoys, and remaining Tyrells allied with Dany organise their strategy, and for the sake of public image, only the Westerosi allies will march on the capital, while the Unsullied instead will attack the Lannister home of Casterly Rock. She's trying to be the good guy, but Olenna suggests embracing her young Jungian dragon self. And before going, Grey Worm and Missandei finally get real with each other and get it on. Hashtag fingers and tongue. Cersei rallies the remaining southern lords that she didn't blow up last season, with Randall Tarly, Sam's dad, being made a commander in her army. And meanwhile, Qyburn has been busy rustling up a solution to the dragon problem with a new scorpion design. So Yara's Greyjoys are sailing over to Dawn with the Sand Snakes to collect the rest of their army, but sexy time is interrupted by a sudden attack. It's Euron's war fleet smashing out of the fog, doing what they do best, murdering at sea. Yara's forces battle against her uncles as things burn all around them, but Euron is a force unto his own, and he personally kills two of the Sand Snakes. Yara is no pushover, but she's eventually defeated and captured, and knowing that there is nothing that he can do to help, Theon makes a swim for it, despite letting his sister down. And so just like that, the majority of Dany's war fleet is smashed at sea. Ser Jorah's grayscale has advanced too far for the maesters to help, but Sam discovers he's the son of Gior, his former commander at the Night's Watch. He's found an old book that might hold the cure, but it's too risky for Marwyn to give him the go-ahead. So in the middle of the night, Sam sneaks in anyway, to carefully perform possibly one of the most disgusting operations ever shown in fiction, but with one of the best jump cuts since Kubrick's 2001. It's Hot Pie, and Arya's come for a visit on her way to kill Cersei, but he gives her the news that the Boltons were defeated by Jon Snow, the king in the north, and she turns around instead to go see her family. And heading back up, she even crosses paths with Nymeria, the direwolf she had to send away after biting Joffrey. Now a giant beast who leads her own pack of wolves, she recognizes Arya, but does not stay. Euron drags his niece and Dornish captives through the streets of King's Landing on his way to see Cersei, and revels in the attention. He gives the Sand Snakes over to the Queen, who declares him a true friend to the crown, and promises Euron his heart's desire once the war is won. So Greyjoy runs the navy, while Jaime commands the army. And Cersei gets to celebrate by giving Tyene the same slow kiss of death that was administered to Princess Marcella, and Ilaria Sand will be forced to watch as her daughter slowly dies and rots in front of her for the rest of her days. And nothing turns the Queen on quite like a bit of sweet murder, so she hits up Jaime for the night, and in the morning makes a point of not hiding anymore that they like to bang. In fact, Cersei's on a roll, as the Iron Bank was rather impressed by the exploding Sept power play, and she convinces them to continue supporting her rule, promising that the crown's debt will shortly be repaid. Back up at Winterfell, Sansa is proving her value as a leader by shoring up the grain supplies and adapting armor for cold weather use. Littlefinger as ever keeps probing for an angle to worm into, take that to mean what you want, and at the gate, Brandon Stark has returned home, reunited with Sansa for the first time since season 1. They chill out by the Heart Tree for a catch-up, but Bran is now the Free-Eyed Raven and not the Lord of Winterfell, and his cosmic knowledge kind of creeps her out. Ser Jorah's grayscale has been cured. Well done, Sam. And of course, the first thing on his mind is to get right back to Dany. For breaking the rules, Maester Marwyn gives Sam a slap down, but proves that he's low-key impressed by not actually banishing him from the Citadel. Jon and Ser Davos reach the shores of Dragonstone to treat with Dany, and the Hand of the Queen and the King in the North are happy to see each other once again. And Tyrion also tells Jon that he never actually put his hands on Sansa, despite their sham marriage, and Dany's dragons pop on over to leave a lasting first impression. Varys and Mel watch from the top of a cliff, and kind of have nothing better to do right now than slightly annoy each other. So Mel is going to pop off over to Volantis for a bit to give Jon some space. In the throne room, Missandei lavishly pours out an introduction for Queen Daenerys Targaryen, and Davos introduces Jon. These two don't know each other, and have no reason to trust one another beyond having a shared enemy in Cersei. Dany puts on a hard front expecting Jon to kneel, and is surprised instead to hear about some kind of army of the dead in the distant north. Well, both their families have history and beef, and both try to look beyond that. But overall, they rub each other the wrong way, and Jon is going to stay for a bit as a guest. Word about the Dornish and the fleet has come in, but Theon at least does get fished up at sea, for whatever he's worth, and meanwhile Jon and Tyrion try to work out each other's problems. And seeing as the dragonglass means nothing to Dany, Tyrion advises her to just let Jon mine it, keeping him happy and busy whilst they focus on the war. There's a moment of connection between the two, but everybody needs to get to work. You see, the next step for Dany and T-Dog is to march on the Lannister home of Casterly Rock. An all-out assault will result in the death of many Unsullied. But back in the day, Tywin put Tyrion in charge of cleaning out the drains. And for the sake of slipping in the odd whore from time to time, he might have dug a secret cave entrance. So, small units open the gates from within and take the castle swiftly, meeting little resistance from the Lannister men. In fact, that's far too small of a resistance, and Grey Worm realizes that the core of the Lannister army isn't there at all.
It's a trap!
And as Euron's ships appear from nowhere to lay waste to the last part of Dany's fleet, Sir Jaime Lannister is actually marching on Dany's other ally, Highgarden, and Olenna Tyrell. It's a surprise move that Jaime learnt the hard way from Robb Stark back in the day. And the castle is captured. So he and Olenna sit down for a catch-up, and he offers her some poison wine to keep things classy instead of letting Cersei torture her. But still, the Queen of Thorns throws one last barb by letting Jaime know that she was the one to poison Prince Joffrey, his son, at the Purple Wedding. So the Lannister forces are marching their way back with all of that Tyrell gold to pay off the Iron Bank, who are impressed by the lump sum. But Cersei is focused on controlling all of Westeros and might need some further reinvestment. Up at Winterfell, Littlefinger tries befriending Bran by gifting him that troublesome Valyrian steel dagger from the first season. But he's not so easily coerced, seeing as he knows everything, and Peter is spooked off his game. Mira Reed needs to return to her family, and sadly, Cosmic Bran is so out of touch with other people now, all she gets is a thank you for several seasons of bitter sacrifice. And Arya too makes it back to the family home. She gets some shit at the gate from some newbies who don't know any better, and takes a moment to drink in the memories from a lifetime ago, before visiting the bones of her father in the crypts below. It's there that Sansa finds her, and another Stark is logged back at base. Two very different sisters are now separated even further by their awful life experiences, and Bran continues to flex his vision power by already knowing Arya's list of names. He gives her the dagger, and Brienne is glad to see the Stark girls both returned home, her original vow now complete. Arya's keen for a workout with the woman who punched the Hound off the side of a cliff, and these two measure each other up, to the point of Sansa realizing that she might be the only Stark left that's not actually turned a bit weird. But Littlefinger finally senses the exploit he's been probing for. Missandei hints at her fun with Grey Worm, and Jon takes a look at Dany's cave,
careful,
which is covered in ancient markings left by the Children of the Forest, showing an alliance with the First Men in a previous war against the others. This further validates Jon's stories about the White Walkers, and Dany agrees to fight for the North once he bends the knee. And he's starting to wonder if the survival of mankind is worth a bit more than just a king's pride. But the bad news about that Casterly Rock Tyrell turnaround puts her into a fury, so she's considering just burning down the Red Keep with her dragons, much against Tyrion's advice. And so she turns to Jon, who manages to talk her down from just being another murderous tyrant. But despite the concerning moment, he and Davos hear of Missandei's experiences with her queen, and how they all serve her out of choice because they truly believe in Dany herself. The Greyjoy scatterings return back with Theon, and Jon's not happy to see him. Theon wants to ask Dany for help in getting Yara back, but she's flown off to vent her frustrations on some legitimate military targets. Jaime's forces have gotten the gold back to King's Landing, but the actual army is stretched thin during the march. And suddenly the rumble of hoofbeats echo over the horizon. The Lannister forces form up a shield wall, but they are suddenly standing in the face of a mounted Dothraki horde, charging in for the kill. Bronn knows a shit situation when he sees one, and Dany swoops over on Drogon to hammer home the point that they're all fucked. Dragonflame burns men to ashes in an instant, and the Blood Riders pour through the breach. It would be a close thing between them and an organized defense under Jaime's command, but Drogon is the Westerosi equivalent of having a nuke. Standard arrows can't pierce grown dragonhide. In the flames and the chaos, men burn, and Bronn is hunted by the Dothraki. But that's enough from you, thank you very much. And he focuses his attention on the skies. From relative safety, Tyrion watches on as his queen destroys the army of his former family. And Jaime can't bear to see so many lives snuffed out in an instant. Dany knows she has to eliminate the threat of bronze scorpion bolts, but the sellsword holds true to wound the dragon before nearly getting roasted. And there's the chance opening. Dany stops to pull the bolt from her dragon, and Jaime knows that he must end this war here and now. Much to Tyrion's fear for both of their lives, and it's only a last second save from Bronn that has him escape the flames below the water. Tyrion walks among the ashes of the aftermath, and Daenerys makes one hell of a sight, as she explains that she's not just here to kill everyone after having just killed almost everyone. And some men bend the knee, but not all. Randall sees no reason to trade his honor over to the man who killed his own father and the foreign invader. So he's to burn Ven, and Dickon refuses anything other than to share his father's fate. Tyrion pleads to take the younger as a prisoner, but they've woke the dragon. Their forces lost, our two men fish themselves out downriver, and Jaime needs to warn Cersei of the dragon threat. But once back, Cersei, with the support of the banks, can just buy some more mercenaries to fill the gap. He tells her of Olenna's involvement behind Joffrey's death in an attempt to divert her away from her hatred towards Tyrion. But the war will go on. Dany returns home, and Drogon seems to take a very particular interest in Jon, much to his surprise and hers. She seems to like that the White Wolf takes no pleasure in killing others and being a king. And, cured of Greyscale, she is, this time, happy to see Ser Jorah's return. In Winterfell, the Lords of the North and the Vale start to fancy Sansa as their new ruler whilst Jon is away. But she only confirms her brother cousin's position as their king. Arya, however, has a thing for reading faces and can see that her sister might actually want to be the one in power. This leads to an argument that really doesn't seem necessary, but Arya is a little too well-conditioned to see the worst in others. And Littlefinger just minces about the place to the point that Arya is so suspicious she reads his letters. But it's all a ploy by Peter to get her to read the note that a scared child Sansa wrote under duress when Ned was imprisoned, deepening the rift. Bran flies recon via a murder of crows over the wall and discovers the army of the dead is heading in the direction of Eastwatch by the sea, led by the Night King at its center. So Bran commands a warning message be sent to everyone. The Maesters are doubtful at the news until Sam steps up to tell them all how it really is back up north. If these men warn everyone to send their forces north, it could sway the tide. But to these learned maesters, it could equally be a ploy from the Dragon Queen to weaken the defences of the south. So for now, the old men will delay and seek clarification, despite Sam having literally seen the dead with his own eyes. Also, now that Gilly can read, she's burning through the history books, and casually drops word that Prince Rhaegar Targaryen quietly annulled his marriage, which will be important later. Well, he can't stomach the inaction. So, just like he did when visiting his family, Sam leaves the Citadel in the middle of the night after stealing some stuff. Tyrion is worried about Dany burning both of the Tarleys, and Varys consents his guilt by association, having felt the same under the Mad King Aerys. So T-Dog hatches a plan to allow them to fight the dead up north without Cersei killing everybody once they turn their backs on her. If they could go beyond the wall and actually capture one of the living dead, they could bring it back to Cersei as proof of something far more important to deal with first. So Davos smuggles Tyrion into King's Landing to actually organise a parley date with the Queen, and both tend to their own business once there. Bronn leads Jaime down amongst the dragon skulls for what he thinks is another training session, but he finds his brother instead. There's a world of mixed emotion between them, the murder of their father, Tywin's intended execution of Tyrion, but he's here because of Dany's far more important request. The Onion Knight finds Gendry smithying back in the city, and Davos barely says a word before Gendry keenly agrees to lend his warhammer to Dany's cause. Playing the old rogue on the way out, he manages to get past some bent gold cloaks, but Tyrion, the most famous dwarf in the country, spoils their near eventless journey by not bothering to look more than 10 feet in front of him and just waiting for the guards to leave. But let's face it, Gendry was keen to be using that hammer. In fact, he's so keen that once they return to Dragonstone, he immediately tells Jon that he's King Robert's bastard son and that he wants to go north beyond the wall to help with the undead kidnapping operation. Yeah, okay. And it's fond farewells all round as Jon, Davos, Gendry and Ser Jorah head off to sail up to the wall. They reach Eastwatch by the sea immediately, and Davos is subbed out of play for Tormund, who has captured the remaining Brotherhood Without Banners, who were heading north as well. So despite some bad blood going on, Voros, Beric and the Hound join in the Fellowship of the Bad Idea and trundle off into the freezing cold. They're not even riding horses! Jaime finds Qyburn tending to Cersei for some reason, and he speaks to the Queen about his surprise meeting with their brother and a proposed armistice to deal with the undead. Turns out Cersei knew all along and knows that she needs to be cunning to beat Dany's stronger army anyway. Plus, she has another reason to win. She's pregnant with Jaime's child. But she's also still a menacing psychopath. Meanwhile, Dany is worried for Jon's safety, and Tyrion lets on that the king in the north might fancy her. Power based on fear is brittle, and she wants to break the generational cycles of wars and tyranny. But when Tyrion actually takes the topic seriously by thinking about how the Seven Kingdoms might be ruled after her, she shuts him down. North of the wall, the super friends get to know each other. Gendry is still sore at the Brotherhood for selling him off to Mel at a sacrifice, but the Hound tells him to stop whinging. And as Lord Mormont's true son, Jon offers his Valyrian steel sword to Ser Jorah, but the knight knows he lost his claim to it long ago, and leaves Longclaw in Jon's care. As they go, the conditions become increasingly worse, and then, what's that? It's a zombie bear! And the boys huddle up on defense whilst Foros and Beric get on flame duty. The Red Priest goes down and takes a terrible wound, but I guess he's fine, and only some nameless wildling redcoats actually die. Spying a small party of the undead, they bait an attack whilst Jon plays his Valyrian steel special, and it turns out that killing an other actually breaks the necromancy holding the dead alive, very conveniently only leaving one, who must have been risen by someone else. Poor guy, looking all nervous. Well, time to go in a sack, buddy, but not before letting out a piercing shriek of alarm, giving away their position. Oh dear. They're suddenly in serious trouble. So Jon tells Gendry to sprint all the way back to Eastwatch to get word over to Dany to tell of what happened, while the rest make for an island of rock in a frozen lake. Frozen just enough, in fact, to let them cross, but not so much that it won't cave in under the weight of an army. Gendry manages to sprint through the freezing cold all the way back to the wall within hours, and the Eastwatch boys get the word out. Next morning, the kidnapped team are still chilling out on Stalemate Island, but Foros has passed away in the night, and they burn the body. The Night King watches them with the patience of the dead, but Ser Jorah surmises that if they can just destroy the head, then the body of the army must die. Back at the Stark home, Sansa and Arya reminisce over Ned being such a solid father figure, until Arya suddenly gets all up in her sister's face over that note that Littlefinger planted, threatening to show it to the other lords to destabilize her leadership. The Lady of Winterfell gets that invite for the armistice meeting down in King's Landing, but she'll be damned if she ever goes back there, and sends Brienne in her place. And after coming across a lovely bag full of faces, Arya herself goes back into full creep mode to give her sister even more shit. And Littlefinger loves it. Although his actual game plan is a bit unclear. Dany gets word from Eastwatch in no time at all, and hops on Drogon to lend a hand with her dragons, even if she has never been there before and doesn't know the way. In the meantime, the Hound screws up, and the Whites realize that they can attack in smaller numbers, without breaking through the ice. So the lads find themselves having to hold ground against an endless stream of corpses that finish off the no-names, and almost tear Tormund to shreds, but magically don't, before he's dragged clear. It's grim and hopeless for them, but there's no choice but to fight on. Just in time though, Dany swoops over, and her dragons start burning the dead to ashes. She sets down with Drogon, who throws a dragon flame defense, while Jon strays away from the group in the fight. But with a possible prescience, this seems to be the very thing that the Night King has been waiting for. Now with a spear of ice, he tracks Viserion and shoots the dragon down with a mortal blow, sinking dead into the water. Not a word is said, but the dragons cry out in lament. Jon also gets pulled under, and with everybody else on board, Dany needs to get moving immediately before the Night King tries to do that again. And having seen the full extent of the army of the dead with her own eyes, they escape. And then, despite several minutes of being submerged in freezing water, Jon pulls himself out. He's still gonna die, but then Uncle Benjen comes out of nowhere with his flaming mace. There's not even time for a hello before he sends Jon off on a horse and dies instead. Luckily, back at the wall, Dany takes a moment over her shocking loss, but they loiter just long enough to spot Jon's return and get him warmed up. Dany can see that he really was stabbed to death at some point, and realizes now just how important things are up north. She's now 100% down for destroying the Night King and his army, and on the sail down south for their meeting with Cersei, Jon recuperates and bends the knee, metaphorically, to call Daenerys his queen, while the Hound watches over their undead cargo. Meanwhile, the dead have returned to that lake with chains, and pulled the body of Viserion out from the waters. It's the catch of a lifetime for the Night King, who reanimates the dragon corpse. Grey Worm and the Unsullied have marched to King's Landing. It's not actually a siege, but more of a siege to be if the negotiation talks don't go well. But it's not just them. The Dothraki have arrived as well. Cersei gets ready for her guests by telling dead Ser Gregor who to kill first if it all goes south, and in march for different negotiation teams. Brienne has already made it down with Podrick, while Bronn welcomes the rest with a Lannister escort. Tyrion is glad to see Podrick, Bronn is glad to see Tyrion, and the Hound and Brienne seem to be cool with each other now, and catch up up over Arya. They all wait to treat with Cersei in the Dragon Pit of King's Landing, and after a tense wait to maybe get killed, once Bronn and Podrick leave, the Lannister Queen enters, with Jaime, Pycelle, and Euron in tow. Sandor tells his dead older brother that there's going to be a reckoning right before Dany makes her grand dragon entrance. Just showing off now. So that's a lot of big personalities in one space together. And Jon gives his usual boring speech about the army of the dead. Well, down in the warmer south, a story like that sounds preposterous and is likely a delay for Dany to build up her army. But the Hound pops back with his white in the box, which makes for a very convincing argument about the possible end to humanity. Qyburn gets a boner, and Jon explains that the problem up north will soon be the problem everywhere unless action is taken. Jaime is stunned, and once Euron realizes they can't swim, he buggers off with his fleet back to the safety of the Iron Islands. And so Cersei offers to accept a temporary truce as long as Jon promises to keep the north out of it when she and Dany go back to war. But those damn Starks are stubborn about the truth, and Jon admits that he's sworn himself to the Targaryen queen, spoiling the moment for everyone. Yeah, well done. Brienne and Jaime can't think how to resolve this, and everybody else is busy telling Jon to maybe shut up once in a while, seeing as Dany lost one of her dragons in order to get them this far. So at great risk to his life, Tyrion visits his sister to negotiate alone. Cersei is on the cusp of having him killed right there. He tore the family apart after murdering their father, which allowed the vultures of the other houses to pick away at Tommen and Marcella until their deaths. Tyrion, however, loved those two greatly, and he has his own baggage regarding Tywin, so the close moment of his death passes for now, and they talk. Cersei lets Tyrion realize that she's pregnant and has something worth protecting, and the rest of the meeting goes unheard. Meanwhile, Dany hates the idea of her ancestors having once locked away their dragons in a pit, despite having locked her own dragons away in a pit for most of the last two seasons. And then everyone returns to the meeting, where Cersei confirms that she will not stand down her forces, but in a surprise 180, will instead actually use them to help Jon and Dany in the fight against the others in the army of the dead. So back on Dragonstone, Dany and Jon plan to sail up north together to show a united front. And oh yeah, Theon's here. He laments his past awful actions to Jon, and it's not an easy time between them. But despite betraying his house, Robb, and the memory of Ned, Jon forgives Theon, letting him be both a Greyjoy and a Stark. And so riding his new high, Theon calls for a rescue mission with the remaining Ironborn to go get Yara. Their captain takes the traditional Kraken attitude towards the weak, but after a good year or two of torture from Ramsay, a simple beating just doesn't scare him. Plus, apparently having your dick cut off makes you impervious to crotch pain? What? And so he wins out, his confidence anointed for the very first in a long time. Sansa gets the news about Jon essentially swearing the entire North into Dany's service whilst he was away on holiday, and she is pissed. Littlefinger suggests maybe unnaming the king, but Arya the Killer would not let that happen, so he gives her some more advice designed to isolate her away from her family and over to him, and Sansa takes a while to think on these words, before having Arya and the lords assemble in the main hall. Sansa must defend her house against foes that would do harm, and facing Arya calls out the charges of murder and treason. Not at her sister, however, but at Lord Baelish. Stunned, Littlefinger is lost for words, and Sansa tells everyone that he killed Aunt Lysa up in the Vale after conspiring with her to kill Jon Arryn, the man who Ned had to go and replace as Hand of the King. In fact, the entire conflict between the North and the South was sparked by Littlefinger's scheming, and now they know it. Peter would suddenly like to go home, but Lord Royce isn't his friend, and after Sansa thanks Littlefinger for his many lessons, Arya cuts his throat with the same knife he held to Ned's neck. And so the Stark sisters are cool with each other, remembering the words of their father. Sam has also made it to Winterfell to say hi to Bran, who needs to tell Jon that he's Rhaegar Targaryen's bastard son with Lyanna in Dorne. But Sam's got an even bigger truth bomb. He knows from the Citadel that Rhaegar annulled his first marriage and put a ring on Lyanna. Now that he knows what to look for, Bran confirms this from his cosmic knowledge. The War of Robert's Rebellion was built on the lie of Rhaegar kidnapping Lyanna, but in truth they loved each other, and Jon is in fact legit. Which means that on the boat ride north, as Jon and Dany give in to their feelings for each other, he's actually having sex with his aunt. But by Game of Thrones standards, that's probably not such a big deal. And back in King's Landing, Jaime is actually pumped to be part of a united front of honourable people fighting against a definably evil enemy. Queen Cersei interrupts his battle plans, however, to tell him that all that talk of helping was a lie. Jaime is convinced that this war against the light and the dark is important, but Cersei would rather just see the Starks and Targaryens all killed off instead. Plus, Euron is really taking his fleet over to Essos to pick up a massive army of sellswords to bolster the Queen's cause. Jaime is gutted that she conspired behind his back, and he's finally sick of all of her betrayals. Nobody walks away from the Queen, but Jaime doesn't blink and offers her the chance to kill him. And so alone he leaves King's Landing, the snows falling even in the south. Winter has come, and it might well be the very last one that anybody ever sees. Because over at Eastwatch by the Sea, the dead have arrived to finally march on the wall. Everyone who has died in the far north march a legion with the White Walkers. Tormund and Beric hope that they're out of reach, but the Night King flies in on his dead dragon, a weapon so powerful and magically imbued that it can even overcome the old magic of the wall itself, breaching it with ice blue flames. And so for the first time in 8,000 years, the wall has fallen, and now the dead march on the kingdom with nothing to stop them, the greatest and most terrible army the realm has ever seen. Oh my god. So, the Starks of Winterfell finally have a united front. Cersei has ordered in more military to continue being awful with Euron, and Jaime's had enough of her. Everyone else left in Westeros is sworn under Dany's rule, whether they know it yet or not. And despite that, Jon Snow has this whole time been the one true legitimate Targaryen king. Poor Viserys was never in the running. Remember him? So it's Cersei and Euron versus everyone else, and everyone else versus the dead. Thanks a lot for watching, guys. I really hope you've enjoyed having Game of Thrones Season 7 crammed inside of you. Making these in-depth recaps of the series instead of just a quick overview takes ages. And so a great big thank you to anyone who's watched, commented, or subscribed. It's been really motivating, so thanks again. I'll see you next time, and take care.